Mass Effect, and in that scenario, I think it might be...
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. It is E3 time, finally, fucking E3 2018. Christmas for gamers, constantly referred to. I'm right here. I'm watching GameSpot stuff. Here's my little, my reaction, whatever, to EA's bullshit. I'm starting this recording pretty early, mainly because I just want to watch the pre-show, but I'm probably going to skip ahead until the actual conference starts. But yeah, fucking going to EA. Before we get started, I just want to say, like, what I guess I expect for EA. What I expect is, well, of course, we're going to see Anthem. Hopefully, we get to see real gameplay this time, and we don't get the Mass Effect Andromeda fucking behind-the-scenes video and shit like that. Because nobody really gives a fuck unless you care about game development. Like, me, I'll look at game development videos, but, like, in terms of on the show floor, nobody wants to see that. Right now, Battlefield 5, of course, we're probably going to see some, like, they're probably going to talk, like, who knows, 10 minutes on Battlefield 5. Or just show, like, a whole gameplay sequence of, like, buildings getting destroyed or something like that. Maybe something for Dead Space? Most likely not, since Visceral doesn't exist no more, because EA takes away every fucking... EA just hates good games, right? We're probably going to see something about Star Wars. EA will either constantly refer to how their games won't have loot boxes or microtransactions or something like that. Or they'll just not speak about it whatsoever because EA's fucking stupid. Let's be honest, EA's fucking stupid. What else? What else do I actually expect going into EA? I'm be honest, I really don't expect much. I don't expect much anymore. Like, I expect that they're going to show some sports thing and I'm going to fall asleep for that. And or maybe just go make me a sandwich and come back and do my taxes or something like that. Because they spend like an hour talking about that shit. They're probably going to talk about esports again. Yeah, that's it. I really don't have anything for EA that I'm excited for, per se. Nothing that I'm, like, crazy ecstatic for. Like, I'm pretty sure we're gonna get, I'm pretty sure I'm gonna be excited to see some stuff, right? Fucking what we're seeing right now is not real gameplay for Battlefield 5. But, oh man, fuck Battlefield 5 and women, right? But, yeah, that's all I got for now. So I'm gonna skip until the post-show actually starts. I mean, not post-show, till the conference actually starts, and I'll see you guys there.
They got you points and tickets, but outside of that, they had no...
Alright, so we're here. We're doing it. Alright, we're starting off EA. Start off E3 with EA here. Fucking them their goddamn sizzle reel. Don't show Star Wars. Don't show Star Wars. You don't have the fucking right anymore. Alright, that's pretty good. Okay. Alright. Alright, you got me. So I'm guessing they're kicking it off with Anthem, the Iron Man simulator. Alright, you guys got it.
Oh my gosh, how cool is that? So that was Anthem. We're going to talk about that a little bit later in the show. But welcome everybody to EA Play. I'm Andrew Renee, and while you might recognize me from the gaming community,
I don't recognize you. I'm sorry. Okay, so she's a new face. There you go. Cool.
Because they know that I'm both a gamer and a fan, so they invited me to come and host the show. And I think this year is going to be a lot of fun, you guys.
Let's chill out with the word gamer. Let's chill the fuck out with that word this year, please. Even from Sony, even from Microsoft, even from Ubisoft, I don't want to fucking hear gamer so many fucking times that my eardrums bleed.
It's It's a full 3-day gaming festival where thousands of gamers can come and play games for free. Now, inside the theater here, there are hundreds of community members from all over the world who are going to be capturing, streaming, and getting their first impressions of the games that we're going to be showing off here today. But before we can get to that, we've got some reveals, of course. We're going to kick things off with a look at Battlefield 5 multiplayer. Now, I know Trevor Noah gave you the first look. Yeah, we can clap it up. Last month, but we've got some new stuff to show you today. Then we're going to move on to FIFA 19, and boy, do they have some big news, you guys. Any World Cup fans? You guys excited?
Yeah! Sports! Sports ball! Let's do it!
In-games to share, and then I'm going to come back towards the end of the show with some of my favorite developers to give you guys a nice, meaty look at Anthem. And of course, yeah, we got the woos for Anthem. I'm into it.
We got the woos for not real gameplay.
Well, wouldn't it be fun, you guys, if I told you all the secrets at once, right? Give him a break. He needs to just enjoy the show. So without further ado, let's get things started.
Is that a woman? I don't want no woman's in my Battlefield. Nope. They ruined the realism. It's a joke, guys. I joke. That was the joke. Women. Was it necessary to like applaud for that?
It's time to kick this thing off. It's been 2 weeks.
I hope they're applauding for the people and not the words Battlefield. Oh, look at that shitty fucking goddamn live stream they had. That thing sucked.
You want to know how customization actually works? You want to know more about our take on the Second World War?
I think what we want is to really see real gameplay.
Deepest and most immersive battlefield yet.
Every battlefield is the deepest and most immersive.
You will be able to dive and smash through windows to surprise your enemies. Where previously defenses were stationary, you will not be able to move these weapons around on the battlefield and gain advantages.
Okay.
And our renowned destruction system is back and more impactful than ever.
All right. That looks cool.
You can't really hide from those pesky tanks anymore as they come chasing you for you, as they rip through those buildings.
How much you want to bet at the beginning of every fucking, like, someone's going to be like, there's a sniper in there, take the tank. No. And just fucking, all the houses are going to be destroyed in every map within like the first 5 seconds.
You're going to see a lot more of our new gameplay systems here at EA Play from our community. So let's talk about our single player in War Stories.
Yes, let's do that. So we want to tell you about those untold stories that got us excited to start with in this game. It's about... What you will see is really those moments.
Is that a woman? Why is there a woman in my battlefield? I don't like that. Man, it ruins my realism.
Real and really relatable people facing the brutality of war. We started off by an exclusive look at the Nordlys war story over at the Xbox briefing tomorrow.
Thanks, that's something not to miss tomorrow. So, our launch in October is just...
Okay, so we're going to get more information on that during Microsoft's conference. Which is going to be, what, 3 hours?
No premium pass.
Oh, no premium pass? What else do I got to pay for?
Every day...
I really hope I'm not... I really hope I'm not destroying the microphone right now when I scream.
You'll get something I know a lot of you have been asking for.
Mm-hmm. It's... Royale.
No!
it's Royale.
Wow, legit, half that fucking audience literally yelled no. Holy shit.
Into this new experience.
That has to be heartbreaking. Half of them were like, yeah, and the other half was like, no!
Or anywhere else. But, more about that later this year.
I mean, as long as you don't make the game just about Battle Royale, then, and just put it there as, like, a game mode option, then sure, there's no fucking problem with it. I just won't have to play it.
Fighting across multiple maps and modes. Welcome to your next Battlefield experience, and this is your first look at ground operations. And this time, even featuring music.
So, ground operations is the name of the battle royale mode. Yeah, I'm guessing it's named the battle royale mode. Cool. Look at that snow. A lot of snow. I'm beyond, like, I'm probably gonna buy this Battlefield mainly because, Call of Duty fucking World War II wasn't really that good. And I didn't touch Battlefield 1 or 4 or whatever, or Hardlines. I haven't touched Battlefield since, like, forever, so. Exclusive first look in the Xbox. Okay, so. Okay. FIFA! Woo! I always enjoy watching a couple of men handle some balls. I mean, what? What? Well, so this is the sports part of E3. You should just go make a sandwich and fucking and cry yourself to sleep. Do your taxes. Something. I don't know. I'm gonna fucking go to sleep right now. Take me a goddamn nap. It's fuck. It's FIFA. What happened to the fucking sound? Why did it become, like, super quiet? Why did the video become, like, way more quiet? What the hell is that about? Oh, look, it's the World Cup. Cool. That's a dirty ass looking trophy.
The pinnacle of club football, where the world's best clubs compete, and icons of the game like Gerard and Cruyff cemented their legacies. The world's biggest league joins the world's game. And a special thanks to the legendary Hans Zimmer.
I'm not sure if I gotta turn up the volume or not, cause fucking the video just got like way more quiet. Let me turn up the fucking audio.
As Aaron said, the UEFA Champions League is an amazing addition for the game. It's where football's biggest heroes like Ronaldo and Neymar clash every year. And it's the place where champions rise. And you've been asking for this for a long time, and we are thrilled that it's here. And that's why we're bringing the champions.
All right, I turned up the audio. I don't know what the hell happened. I don't know if it's gonna go back to normal or not, but for some reason the audio got like it got lower on the fucking live stream itself. So I don't know what happened there. Are they explaining to me what the fuck the goddamn Champion League is? Or what the World Cup is? Because I'm not listening.
FIFA's gameplay. And this year we're giving you the tools to control the pitch at every moment. From your tactical approach to the match to each technical touch.
Right now, yeah, you're just saying a bunch of the same shit you say every year.
Shape and refine our vision for FIFA 19 with input from our community. From hands-on tests with beginners to detailed feedback sessions with FIFA pros.
Yes, very detailed.
We're sharing a lot more about gameplay throughout the summer, but what I can tell you right now is that the quality bar in gameplay was raised.
What I can tell you right now is that the gameplay of kicking a fucking ball is the same. All right, September 28th, FIFA 19. Cool.
News headlined by the UEFA Champions League. But I just wanted to take a minute to pause and reflect.
If I was on that fucking stage, I would roundhouse kick the shit out of that trophy.
Growing up,
just out of spite.
Every young player dreams of winning.
Oh man, I fucking wish somebody just like took a baseball and just threw it at the trophy right now. It would make my fucking day. Someone just takes their water bottle and chuck it at that fucking trophy.
And with the tournament starting in just 5 days, we're excited for the world to compete for it in FIFA 18.
As you can imagine, all of us on the FIFA team can't wait for the start of the World Cup.
I can't wait for you to get the fuck off the stage. I'm being so cynical right now, but I don't care about sports. I don't care about racing games. Because guess what? You room the car in a racing game. You kick, dribble, and shoot the ball, pass it or whatever in a sports game. It's the same thing. And I understand, like, that's a basic thing for me to say, is that it's the same fucking thing. And I'm pretty sure there's a lot of people who are excited about FIFA and stuff like that, but guess what? You're gonna get it every year. Fucking stop wasting my damn time on a goddamn stage. Talking about FIFA, I get it. Every year it's more intricate. Every year the fucking stadium looks like shit. Every year the fucking... It's the most detailed team player assignment bullshit that you can do in every fucking game. I'm very cynical when it comes to sports games.
Yeah, you can download and play the entire game right now for free.
Okay, see, now that's cool. Announce something like that on E3, yeah. Announce something like that. Don't spend like an hour talking to me about fucking FIFA. Just be like, yo, you can play trial now. Go and play that shit. See, that's cool.
Representing their nations in a little mini World Cup tournament.
And this summer will bring so much more for FIFA fans. Plenty of FIFA 18 content centered around the World Cup. And we'll bring you all the details on FIFA 19. But in the meantime, let's all enjoy the World Cup. Thank you, and auf la vista!
Cool. Alright. Onward to real games. That's probably the most dumbass thing I can possibly say is real game. Fucking the most elitist shit ever. Alright, cool. All you could just came on the stage and said, yo, trial, play it now. That would have been way more worth it than telling me what the fuck the goddamn World Cup was.
The FIFA community never rests. 20 million people from 60 countries playing in competitive leagues this year. Well, the FIFA team never rests either. Bringing the Champions League and the World Cup and so much other greatness to FIFA this year, we can't wait for you to experience it all.
Cool.
We've got so much to do here today, but I want to welcome you to EA Play. It's our third EA Play and our second one in Hollywood, and we couldn't be more excited to have you with us to share all the games that we have to show you. We've got lots to do, but before we move on, I'd like to share just a couple of things. The greatest disruption to the consumption of entertainment media in the last 5 years is the combination of streaming plus subscription. As consumers, watching movies, watching TV, listening...
Where the fuck are you? What is his point with this?
And we believe that disruption is going to be have a profound impact on our industry in the next few years.
Yes, okay.
You will have seen that we announced...
That's common sense.
Electronic Arts to help our investment to extend our thinking and extend our pioneering...
Okay. What?
For many people, that's going to mean extending the experiences they already play on our partner platforms. For others, it's going to mean new games and new modalities...
What the fuck is that smartphone shit? That's... That's kind of cool, I guess. I don't play on my smartphone, but that's kind of cool.
So this week we've got a tech demo running.
Oh my god.
Streaming in HD from the cloud to multiple devices.
Okay. Alright, so now they're trying to do the Xbox, like, Xbox Game Pass thing. I mean, they tried to do that, like, last year, right? With EA Play or whatever, but they never really went hard with it.
And many millions of you have signed up and experienced the joy of being able to have full access to a great catalog of games. Today,
I wouldn't say great catalog, but okay.
So three things you need to know about it. Origin Access Premier will bring you all of...
Can you make Origins work, finally? Because that shit sucks. Origin fucking sucks. I'm sorry, what did he say?
Battlefield 5, and of course Anthem. And there'll be many more titles in the years to come. Second, you get access to the Vault, our library of...
Oh, so those are coming at launch on their EA Play thing?
Come in and play a free trial of Origin Access, our base subscription.
Okay, that's cool. I mean, that's cool. Sure. They're definitely taking the Xbox Game Pass approach with this, where it's like our new releases are coming on our subscription thing. That's cool. Batman? What the fuck does Batman have to do with... Wait, what? Batman's not owned by EA. What the fuck? Is it? Arkham City isn't EA. Oh, I'm guessing they're, like, teaming up with stuff. Okay, yeah. I'm guessing, like, everything on Origins. Sure.
EA Play, and I just happened to find Mr. Vince Ampella here in the audience from Respawn.
Hey, Respawn. Wait, is Respawn the people who do, Titanfall?
I love seeing new games.
I mean, someone's super excited about that event on PC, right? Yeah! So, you guys may have seen that Vince was tweeting yesterday, and there has been a bunch of speculation. So, you want to just get right to it?
Sure. I mean, we're not ready to show all of our stuff yet. We're working on a bunch of stuff. It's amazing. The teams are kicking ass. But we wanted to bring a little tidbit. So we've been working with Lucas on getting the name and kind of the setting for what our Star Wars game is going to be, and we're going to talk about it right now.
Oh, you guys got any guesses? I bet you the internet is going wild right now.
I bet the internet's going wild about no more fucking loot boxes.
Jedi Fallen Order.
Woo! So Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order.
Yeah, so it kind of gives you some idea that you'll be playing a Jedi.
So does that mean I get to, like, hold a lightsaber?
Yes.
Ha 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 ha, lightsaber. Ha ha, it's such a funny joke.
During the dark times, trying to be a little vague here, but when the Jedis are being hunted, so it's going to be spectacular.
So for all the hardcore nerds out there who want to know, like, where in the timeline, like, between which episodes is it?
Between 3 and 4.
Okay. All right, between 3 and 4. That sounds like a nice time. Get it, any other tidbits?
It's not a nice...
What fucking question was that? So, between what episodes is it? He just answered your fucking question. What?
It's amazing.
He answered your question before you even asked the question. What the fuck was that about?
People are now anxiously want to know, like, when can we play? play the game?
It will be holiday of next year, 2019.
And there will be loot boxes. A lot of loot boxes. Prepare your wallet and prepare your ass to get fucked. Because it'll be a lot of loot boxes.
More from you maybe, maybe next year.
Oh, yeah.
Well, Vince.
Oh, yeah. You'll hear about our loot boxes. Great. Okay. Great.
A little bit more news on Star Wars, so I'm going to toss it over to Dennis.
Don't. Stop. Battlefront 2, we have loot boxes.
Hello there, my name is Dennis, I work at DICE in Stockholm on Star Wars Battlefront 2. I'm really happy and excited to be here today, so thank you so much for hanging out with me for a little bit. So, we launched our game in November of last year, and clearly we didn't get it quite right. So instead of coming out of the gate sprinting, like we really wanted to, we had to take a step back.
Look at those loot boxes. Those star cards.
You were delivering the game that our players really wanted.
You don't give a fuck, EA.
We decided to completely overhaul our progression system and add a bunch of new character cosmetics for players to collect instead. So from there, we added a new hunt mode inspired by the original Battlefront games that I love personally, starting with the Ewoks on Endor. And thank you. It turned out to be by far the most popular update of the game, and the team loved building.
I didn't even know they had a fucking new mode. I haven't touched Battlefront 2 in like forever.
In our Han Solo season with content from the movie.
All right, I know about that.
It's headlined by,
man, that movie didn't do good.
Really dangerous place, and it features the return of one of our favorite modes, Extraction. So looking forward a little bit, this summer, we will be introducing a new squad system to the game, which will allow you to team up much easier and play with your friends. We're also adding a new starfighter mode focused around dogfighting with your hero ships. And looking ahead a little bit more, we will also be delivering a new large-scale multiplayer sandbox experience focused around capturing command posts and attacking and taking out capital ships. But that's not all. We know that you have been asking for new heroes, villains, and planets from a certain era that features a very iconic Star Wars conflict. So I'm excited to confirm that Battlefront 2 this year will be going deep into the Clone Wars.
Yeah, the Clone Wars. Hell yeah. The prequels suck.
That we begin on the planet Geonosis, featuring multiple levels, including the largest level we have ever built for Battlefront. So let's talk about the heroes and villains. First,
General Grievous, Obi-Wan. General Grievous!
Powerful droid, the leader of the most powerful droid army in the galaxy, General Grievous. And yes, he will be going up against my own personal favorite, Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Yeah, how did I call it? How do I call it? The most fucking basic thing ever. I'm just excited because General Grievous. I like General Grievous. Count Dooku. There you go. Mace Windu. Shit. Anakin Skywalker. Okay, no Mace Windu, but okay.
The team at home is extremely building all of these cool things. EA and DICE are committed to Battlefront. We had a rough...
Why? Why are you forsaking me? No! What the hell was that for? No! No! Come on, man! What the fuck? Oh no, I'm missing it. I'm missing it. I'm missing everything. No! Don't play that. Fuck! Why you do this to me? Why they do this to me? That's fucked up. No! Now they're doing Unravel 2. Shit. I hope I didn't miss too much. Damn it. Yarny's cool, though. Is it coming out today? Yeah! We love Yanni. I love this guy.
Hi. It's really good to see you. In Unravel, we used yarn to symbolize love and the bonds between people. In our new game, we tear that bond up right at the start. You lose everything, including your spark. But when things are at their darkest...
Yarny has a friend!
And your spark is rekindled. And it leads you off...
That's awesome.
So welcome to Unravel 2.
Oh, it's two, because there's two Yarnies. Yarny and Stringy.
About fresh starts and second chances. These two little souls refuse to give up and will build something new and beautiful together. And the whole game is inspired by that spirit of optimism and togetherness. You see, it's all made to be played with two characters. You can play it alone, or you can play it in co-op with a friend.
I'm gonna play that game in fucking co-op.
Sharing one yarn and working together to get through this adventure. This game, it's quite different from the first. It's both friendlier and more challenging, but above all, it's a lot more playful. And we think it's a worthy successor. And I want to show it to you now, so I brought some help. So please welcome Michael to the stage.
So, hi, Michael. You're going to help us here.
And we're going to try to show you a little bit of what I'm talking about how you can play the game in co-op with yourself, essentially.
Unravel is fucking awesome.
This wasn't prepared.
Oh, I wasn't prepared. Damn it.
Playing it by yourself, you can essentially pick up the other character and carry them along through the more fast-paced segments of the game. And we actually tried to include a bit more of those, because we figured that since it's a co-op game, we wanted to have more, like, thrills.
That looks great. That looks fucking amazing.
Fun and exciting.
Yarny's so fucking awesome. Man, when the first Unravel was announced, I was looking forward to that game like crazy.
When you're problem solving, you can split apart into two and switch back and forth between the two characters. Because that's how...
Man, look at this Toy Story-esque crazy shit going on right here.
...together and helping each other out and utilizing this bond between you to overcome any obstacle that you come across. So I guess I'll jump in.
This guy come here. So, I'm gonna be the red one.
Okay.
Be the blue one.
I'll be blue. Little celebratory flip. And the bird is back. Okay. Playing it safe right now.
So is this only local multiplayer, or is this like online multiplayer as well? Because that would be fucking awesome. It'll probably be online multiplayer as well because of the crazy awesomeness that was A Way Out. Fucking A Way Out was so fucking good. Look at that fucking platforming. That looks fucking amazing.
Oh, Buster. Oh, sweet. Well done. Okay, I'll go up and distract the grouse, and I'll sneak up here. Okay, your turn.
Yeah. Look at me.
There you are. Keep him over to the left. Now I'll go.
All right. I'll you. There you go.
That's fucking awesome.
So that's a quick little look at Unravel 2.
That's awesome. Great job, man. Can't wait for it.
I really hope you like it. And before I go, I just want to send some love to the team back home, because working on this game has been a completely amazing team effort on so many levels, and everybody has worked so hard. So there's a bunch of us from Coldwood here, and thank you to those, and thank you to everybody back home, and thank you. Love you.
So when does that come out? When does Unravel 2 come out? That game looks fucking amazing. That's great. I'm like completely mesmerized by this shit. Look at this. When does it come out?
These guys have done an amazing job, and it's clear that they have a lot of passion, and I can't personally wait.
They got more passion than the whole fucking company of EA itself.
Amazing is that we will make Unravel 2 available to everyone today. You heard that right.
Yes!
You'll be able to take these two yarnies on their next big adventure starting today. The game is finished. It's out.
The game's out. Guess what I'm playing after this shit? Amazing.
Back in 2015, we started this journey with the original Unravel to seek out the most creative independent developers and bring them into our EA original.
Best thing that came out of fucking EA for the past 5 years, Unravel.
Games to the world and to tell their stories. And last year, if you remember, Joseph Fares was up here on stage.
Way out. And he said, fuck the Oscars. Fuck EA. Fuck the Oscars.
And it's something fresh and new, and you all love it.
They said we can't put that man on stage no more.
Players in the first 2 weeks. And A Way Out is such a huge success that Joseph and his team are expanding and moving into a new studio. So stories like this...
Wow, you guys still kept him there. You know why? You know why they kept him there? Because that game was so good, and on top of that, they don't want to become the new Konami. Best thing that ever came out of EA was their fucking indie games.
And it's unlike anything we have ever done. So please welcome Connie Gepper to the stage from Joe My Game.
Unravel 2. Holy shit, I can't wait to play it! Sea of Solitude, that looks fucking awesome. Look at that artwork.
Oh, thank you, Patrick. I still remember during the pitch how enthusiastic Patrick was, and then afterwards, like, the
ooh,
whole team.
Look at that art style. That looks awesome.
It actually feels a little bit the same right now. I'm pretty excited. Maybe a little too excited.
Let me look up Unravel 2 while this is going on, because I'm excited for this shit.
Small indie game studio from Berlin, and we are developing Sea of Solitude, or SOS as we call it. The whole journey from the very first concept to actually becoming a part of EA Originals is simply amazing. Let me tell you more about our game. When humans get too lonely, they turn into monsters. This is at the core of everything you will see, hear, and hopefully feel while playing SOS. What makes this underlying concept so important and so unique is that nearly every human being can at least somehow relate to or remember the feeling of being lonely. In my case, I started writing the story when I felt the loneliest in my life. I think as an artist, you process your emotional world by letting it out and putting it into your art. I'm still amazed how like the concept seems to just float out of me like right into the hand and onto the paper. I think this is also why so many people can instantly connect with the game, because it's not a made-up story, even though that it takes place in a fantastic setting. In SOS, we try to show how people experience different kinds of loneliness, but also how outsiders, friends, and family see those who struggle. We keep all this in playful ways, so that players who want to simply enjoy a fantastic experience can do so, but player who wants to look a bit deeper can reveal a whole emotional world beneath it all. Sea of Solitude is about a young woman named Kay who is suffering from such strong loneliness that her inner feeling, the darkness, the anger.
The darkness. I like the way she said that. The darkness. Like it's Kingdom Hearts.
The game is about finding out why this happened to her, but also how to turn her back into a human. Ultimately, the goal is to bring all those emotions into balance. Some needs to become bigger, some would be better off a little smaller, but to embrace even your destructive part or your self-doubt in the same way you embrace your joy or your hope. This is what being human is all about. And that's what our game is all about. Thank you.
All right. Oh, hell yeah, look at this. This looks fucking cool. Holy shit. A new day is here, but nothing is new. Alone in my room, I tremble for you. Alright. Early 2019. Can't wait to see that shit. Holy fuck. That looks fucking amazing. Oh, God. More sports. I'm just going to go to sleep now. I'm just going to go to sleep and dream about Yarny. All right, cool. Sports. This is my squad. Cool. Great. Don't talk no more about it, please. Just move on. Just move on. Fucking god. They did this shit last year with the goddamn with the esports shit. Guess what? Everybody hates losing way more than they love winning. Fucking idiot. What a fucking idiot. Please don't bring him on stage. Please don't. Notice how nobody applauded you because nobody gives a fuck.
How you doing?
I've been good. You sore coming from that butt whooping?
Wow. Already started. Okay. Hi, everybody.
Wow. Best way to fucking do E3, have a white person belittle a black man on stage. That's fucked up. I shouldn't say that. I really shouldn't say that. But fuck. Reluctantly, the crowd clapped to make it not awkward.
Young kid, how has it been, you know, your success and your path, you know, to where you're at today?
I've always been a competitor.
You know, man, I've always been a competitor. I stay at home, never got a real job. Just live in the basement with my mom, you know. He's screaming at the TV whenever I get mad and lose online. You know, blaming on lag all the time. So it's just that's what we do, you know.
So the key to be the number one player in Madden is to hurt your arm in baseball. That's number one. Number two, you said you had the decision to go to your graduation or go to the tournament. So, like, what did you do?
You know, man, I just stayed at home and cried because my mom wouldn't take me to the tournament. So, you know.
That's awesome. Okay, now, the past few years, how has it been for you? I know you had some ups and downs.
It's been tough.
I mean, man, yo, it's been tough, man. Like, my life's been really tough. You can tell by all the holes I got in my pants. I really don't have that much money because I spend it all on fucking your Madden bullshit. And I just waste my time, you know? Just needed this fucking plastic-ass belt around my fucking shoulders.
EA Play, you know, first look at the Madden Lightning trailer. Super excited. It's going to be so fun. It's lit. I honestly wish I could stare right here and talk to you guys forever. But I'm not going to bore you guys. We're going to go out.
I'm trying to take this belt. Give me that. Don't even. Don't fight me. Give me it. We in jail now. Give me them shoes. I want them shoes. They're my shoes. Give me them shoes. You know why I took your shoes? Why? Because I fucking can. I'm battling the pain of fucking watching this shit right now. I know that much. Yeah, basement kings are born through the legends of playing Madden. It was told in the prophecies that the true basement lord will come one day if he just kept playing enough Madden and drunk a bunch of Mountain Dews and ate Doritos all the time. Gotta get those EXP. Double XP points, man. The weekend's almost up. It's a short weekend. Oh, Jesus Christ, I don't give a fuck about no sports. Thank God, are we done with sports? Can we never see them again? Please.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Nathanius, professional shoutcaster here alongside
professional scream lord here on stage to scream about sports and waste your fucking time. Can we go back to Yarny? Please.
At a brand new mobile game in a live winner take all head to head match. Michael,
whoa, sports. Oh, it's not sports. Okay, it's just tactical stuff. Cool. Man, definitely wanted to watch a fucking a goddamn iOS game here at E3 on a fucking stage. Oh, Jesus Christ, I'm gonna kill myself. Make some noise. Nobody made any noise. You had like one woo.
His opponent, fighting for the red side of the room, a competitive mobile gaming phenomenon. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Nick at Night.
Oh, two woos for Nick at Night. Cool, nobody cares. Nobody cares. I'm loving this. Nobody gives a fuck. I'm loving this. Wow, this is...
Let's kick this off. Nice little strategy game.
Wow.
It's a good genre. I'm very excited for this. The players are loading in, and we are ready to kick this. Here we go.
Wow. Didn't nobody at E3 last year fucking realize that all the shoutcasting shit that we had at last year's E3 was fucking terrible and nobody liked it? I mean, that should have been apparent since fucking Ubisoft did their Eagle Flight shit. Like, come on, man. Get the fuck out of here. Nobody gives a fuck.
In control's going from the top side, also very important as Nick at Night's forces have to circle around the center.
Right, let's see if he's able to create a 2-on-1. Is he able to get there? Looks like he's getting there. Here comes GDI with Rhino. He's gonna rip up the...
Cool. Going for the anti-infantry. They're tapping on their phones. Great. Hey, do any of you guys have the one friend that whenever you're trying to talk to them or, like, just conversate with them or be a normal human being, like, all they do is play Clash of Clans, and then you, like, you're like, great, you're not engaging in conversation, so just fuck off, right? This is the type of shit that I feel right now, where it's like, hey, man, we're all here hanging out, and you keep being on your fucking phone playing Clash of Clans, like... We took the time to come and hang out with you and shit like that, and you're just being, you know, you just don't care, so bye, leave, waste my fucking time. Alright, man, this is just, I don't give a fuck, holy shit. Man, this looks, it's a mobile game. It's a strategy game. That's cool.
He does contest the missile, putting it in the yellow position.
Now, very important, of course, blocking the pathing of those units is another big factor of the strategy. Holding those locations is so crucial as In Control begins to secure the northwest spot. Another tank's going to come out from Nick at Night to take it out, but now he's bringing out the Pitbull as well to help lock down that north position.
This missile is very, very close to firing. Let's see what's going to happen.
With another turret, In Control flakes, he takes the top of that missile, and that fires.
Wow.
And Nick at Night.
Man, look at that. Cool. Red guy is getting fucked up by blue guy. Evil guy is getting beaten by good guy. That's cool.
As more Nick and Knight's forces move up towards that north position, those harvesters, of course, very crucial, very important to protect those as your economy allows you to get these big...
Oh, God. I gotta wait till that missile loads. Man, just give up. Just let the missile meter full. Just give up. The quicker you're done, the quicker we don't have to watch this shit. Just give up. Just give up. That's all you gotta do. Give up.
See what your opponent is doing and make the proper response. It's so important in strategy.
Absolutely. Nick and Knight cruising around, thinking about harassing those harvesters, coming around the far side for those rhinos. Looks like he's really pressing it.
See, that missile is starting to get close to firing with three zones in control for Nick and Knight.
Anybody looking at their watches? Because I am. Even though I don't have a watch on my fucking arm. Oh, God. When did this start? This started at, like, what? This started at 2 o'clock? We're, like, an hour in now or something like that? And Jesus Christ, I just want to... I just want to kill myself. Just let him win. Just let him win. Just let him win. Just let him win. Let him win.
Control can get this in position. He's going to do some serious damage.
That missile just passed halfway ready. He's also bringing out his first air unit.
Wow. Deal with those. A lot going on here.
He's got a lot of range, that big boy, and in control just needs some.
This missile is nearly going to fire.
It could be stolen at any.
Oh, man, look. It's so exciting. Oh, yeah. Great. You can go home now. You can go home. You can go home. Good game, guys. You can get the fuck off the stage.
Let's hear it for Nathanius, Nick and Knight, and in control.
Oh, now we got like a total of 5 claps and woos. Great.
Reveal of Command and Conquer rivals.
All right, now more people are excited. Okay, cool. I mean, it's not that bad of a mobile game. It's just don't show it on the fucking E3 stage floor. It's a waste of time. Like, it's not a bad game. I can see that already, but it's like, nobody gives a fuck.
That Android players can play the pre-alpha today. So head to the Google Play Store, search Command & Conquer Rivals. The studio has been having an absolute blast playing this game, and we can't wait for you to play. Please let us know what you think. Thank you.
I mean, it's a good game. Again, it's a good game. Just don't waste our time. What is that? Is that that's not Anthem. What am I talking about? That's a trailer for their mobile thing. Yeah, there we go. Only the white man can truly take out the power of the white lady. Black man never stood chance. Oh, you're closing the show? Cool. Man, well, EA? You waste my fucking time.
So, as you look at the 10 experiences that you're going to see today, and as you play games this week, there's some things we hope come through. First, that at the very core is choice, is that you as players get to choose how you play, what you play, when you play, and what devices you play on. That in making those choices, you feel you are treated fairly, that no one is given an unfair advantage or disadvantage for how they choose to play.
What the fuck is he talking about right now? I don't... Choices of what? What game on stage did you show that had anything to do with choice so far? What the fuck? What do you mean choices? People want to play on Xbox, they go play on Xbox. Want to play on PlayStation, go play on PlayStation. Want to play on Nintendo or PC, you go and do that shit. The fuck you talking about? You're talking nonsense. Man, fuck this. Jesus. I really wish PlayStation would stop doing that. What do you mean no more memory? Fuck it, I got like over a terabyte of memory. Waste my fucking time. Can't believe this shit happened again. Twice. It happened twice. Oh god, how long is it? This is a 30 minute fucking ad. Are you kidding me? There's a 30 minute fucking ad. Wow.
Announcing the commencement of the first.
I mean, not 30 minute, 30 second. Shit.
Services will be suspended.
Come on, get to Anthem. Get to Anthem. Get to Anthem. Get to Anthem. Get to Anthem.
The first purge. Rated R.
Thread. These three organizations, the United Nations, He for She, PACE's National Bullying.
Okay, more. Alright, they're doing, they're doing their charity stuff. Cool.
And thank you for your support.
Cool. Charity's always great.
Thousands of us at EA and
I mean, at this point it kind of feels like damage control because you guys fucked up so much over the past year, so.
And thanks for the incredible privilege of making games for all of you. Now without further ado, let's take a look at Anthem.
All right, Anthem. Let's see it.
The gods
vanished. Fucking get rid of that goddamn.
And left.
Come on, get rid of that shit.
Creating. Altering. Destroying.
The bar won't go away for some reason.
The anthem is all that remains.
I don't know why the bar won't go away. I can't make it go away. Who cares a fuck anyways? Goddamn EA things suck. I'm seeing no real gameplay right now. So, yeah.
Something is out there. It wants to destroy us all.
Fucking, can I get rid of this goddamn, like, bar that... It won't leave. Okay, well, no gameplay. Is that it? Are we done? Oh, I forgot. Yeah, they're gonna have an in-depth talk. I forgot they were doing that. I'm trying to get rid of this fucking, like, bar down here. It won't go away. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. I'm sorry for the shitty... Oh, there we go.
...about Anthem since last year, because we're all Firework fans. So we're gonna do something a little bit different for the rest of the show, and we're gonna take a deep dive into Anthem. So I'm gonna bring up some members of the Firework team to chat with us. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Casey Hudson, Mark Dara, and Kathy Rutzard.
Okay. Okay, that's cool. We're gonna have a nice little talk show here. Alright. I'm excited. I'm excited. Can we see real gameplay while this is going on, please? Or are we just gonna talk?
It's gonna be very exciting. So, Casey, we're gonna go ahead and just jump right in and get started with you. So now, we know that you all started, because you started your career at BioWare way back in the day. You took a couple years off. But before you came back, you actually worked on Anthem before you left.
Yeah, that's right. So, you know, first of all, it's amazing to be back. It's awesome to be making games for BioWare fans. You know, we have the best fans. So it's been super satisfying to come back to it. And, you know, I just want to be able to continue the legacy of the studio. And that's kind of where it started with Anthem, is just thinking about You know, we know the evolution of a Bioware game, and we wanted to create a brand new world for people to discover, you know, a whole new world of story and character.
We wanted and needed to create a brand new world because Mass Effect sucked so bad.
We also wanted to do something where, you know, if you wanted to invite your friends into it, then you could do that as well. So that was really the initial vision of the game, not an MMO, not a multiplayer game with stories sort of bolted on the side, but something new and different, and I think the team has really captured that vision over the years.
Your fans really love stories from BioWare, but I think we're kind of curious how you're planning to make the story work in this shared world.
Well, actually, Anthem secretly takes place in the world of Mass Effect, and it takes place in the Andromeda galaxy far, far in the future. You might see a Krogan or two.
Now, you can build a solution to that, but you have to really build it into the core of the game, and that's what we've tried to do with Anthem. It's what we call our world, my story. So when you're out in the open world, the world's really dangerous, and you're focused on your mission. And this is where other players get to play with you. The thing that's really interesting about this, that's unique for Anthem, is that this is a living shared world. So whether there's weather, or it's nighttime, what we're experiencing, we're experiencing together. Everyone's playing Anthem at a moment is seeing the same thing. And this is what we mean when we talk about our world. It's a shared world that we all experience together. But then when I finish my mission, I come back to a base.
Then when I finish my mission, I go back to the hub world and I buy a bunch of loot boxes to get more parts for my mech. You know, and I spend a lot of money. I think I spend over $300 within one sitting trying to get a fucking rocket launcher on my shoulder. But I just never got it, you know. It really made me disappointed. I know I'm giving EA and Anthem a lot of shit here. I really am. But I'm being honest, I am kind of excited to see what this game actually really is.
From our community, is they want to continue to play in our worlds when they've finished Mass Effect or Dragon Age. Players want more story. And so we've designed Anthem in a way...
Never going to make another Dragon Age game, and we're never making another Mass Effect. We killed it. We murdered it. And if we fuck up one more time, then EA's going to kill us.
Can you speak to what it's like to create a new world like Anthem from the beginning?
Well, what's really exciting for us, and not just the writers, but all of the devs, the designers, the artists, is that we're creating something new and mysterious for players to discover. So at the heart of the premise of Anthem is a world left unfinished by the gods. But the gods left behind their massive tools, and those tools are in constant conflict with this unknowable force called...
The gods left behind their massive tools. It was a relic known as the Iron Man. So then we took that and we made more Iron Men. And some Iron Women, too. And then that's the lore. We did it. The gods forsaken us. It all started when a certain enemy of the gods snapped his fingers and half the world was destroyed.
Now we've seen all these different creatures, and Mark, you mentioned the storms. What's the process of creating a game like from scratch?
Yeah, it's something we've done a few times at BioWare. You know, and really the hardest part is getting...
Fucking, it said Triumph as one. I thought it said Trump is one, and I'm like, what? I'm like, Trump, what does he got to do with Anthem?
Universe that's meant to bring out a certain experience. And then once we do that, then we still need to build all the rest of the stuff, and what unlocks us creatively is to think about, like, principles around art style, tone, and even the technology and the politics of our new world. And then from there, we can actually go and build out every last detail.
Yeah, and one of the unique challenges for Anthem is that meant to feel alive, like it's happening right now. And so the world is always changing, weather, the storms, seasons, and it's a really great concept to write for, because what it means is it gives us the opportunity to drop into the world almost in real time, a dramatic event that changes the world for everyone. And that can be anything from gameplay to lore.
I mean, all of the movie parts of the dynamic world sound really cool, the way that they sound like they're going to come together. But even though there's obviously a lot going on, it really all comes back to your character. So let's talk about who we're going to be playing as and why we're fighting.
We're going to be playing as a creative character.
You need those suits to survive and fight in this world, because the world will kill you. But on top of that, our ancient rivals, the Dominion, have...
So this is an exosuit and not a power suit. Oh, okay.
...of creation, and so we need to stop them and protect the free people of Tarsus.
Now, I've heard about this power armor a couple different things. Is it a suit? Is it a javelin? Like, what's the canon term here?
We call them javelins because, we took a lot of inspiration from the Bible, and we are the spear that stabbed Jesus, and he bled. I want the fastest suit. I don't want the power suit. I want the one that made me really fast.
We built the suits to look like they're built from the materials of the world, so they each have their own unique abilities. So let's take a look at the Ranger now. The Ranger is a more generalized suit, able to do a lot of different things, really designed for up.
Okay. All right, there's real gameplay. Now we're seeing real gameplay. That looks pretty cool. Of course I'm picking my fave. I want the one that makes me the fastest.
Casey tweeted, some of you may have seen, asking for...
it's all about speed.
...questions. And the first one is going to be from @itsweetnicole, who asks, as a player who is all about making their character their own, what kind of customization options will be available in Anthem?
Yeah, so we really want players to express themselves, both through customizing the way their job...
It looks like they're taking some cues from Warframe, actually, in terms of customization and looks of the suit.
Teams to be able to do this as well, and because you're going to be using a javelin for a long period of time, we really want you to be able to make it your own.
I'm glad you brought that up, because actually, Jay Legato has a question connected to customization. Monetization. How, when, loot box, cosmetics?
Yeah, so we are going to have some cosmetics and band items.
There we go!
But you're always going to know what you're going to buy before you spend any money on it. So no loot boxes, no ability to pay for power. So that means no ability to...
Don't clap for that, because you know what that means? That fucking means... That means that you can either spend 2 hours getting this fucking... this one gun that's going to be invalidated within 5 minutes. Or you can just give me, you know, $1, and I'll give it to you. And then that'll be invalidated within 10 minutes. And then give me another $1, I'll give you a new gun.
That's really all I wanted to know, I'm going to be honest. All right, Casey, we talked earlier about this being a co-op experience. So can you tell me a little bit about how the team gameplay in Anthem is going to work?
Yeah, it really is about...
Why not just make the game like Monster Hunter, dog? Just do that. Just do that. You ain't got to buy shit in Monster Hunter. You work for your shit, and when you get it, you feel good, and it's amazing. Just make it like that. Fuck microtransactions. I'm so tired of y'all bullshit.
Strong, you know, in melee combat. And then here you've got the Ranger shooting down from above. And then they're using combos and special abilities and stuff like that.
Give me the fastest suit with the biggest sword, and then I'll buy your game.
Because at the Slate Tones wants to know, how will you balance multiplayer with single player storytelling?
So Anthem's really built around trying to combine the impact impact of having your own personal story with the fun of playing with other players. But we really want to make sure that that playing with other people feels like a choice. So for people that want to just experience the story, you're going to be able to do that. Now going out to an open world like this by yourself is going to be a little bit more challenging than if the team of four people. And we've really tried to balance the co-op experience to be fun even for people that don't normally engage in these kind of things. So I really hope that everyone at least gives co-op a try.
Okay, that's good to know. If you want to roll solo, you can, but it's just going to be a little bit more difficult. Well, I know you all are on the edge of your seats.
Not really.
Show a little gameplay? Yeah? You guys want that? All right, so Kathy, I think you're going to set this up for us?
I will. So, you and your friends have decided to play a mission called Scars and Villainy. The Scars have put together an acid-based super weapon, so you got to take them out. So you start in the Strider, which is like a giant walker, and it's your forward base of operations. You have a conversation with your crew, Halleck, Faye, and Owen, and you'll hear Owen. He's going to talk us through the mission as we experience it here.
Yeah, you'll hear Owen with his fake online chat. He's going to be like, "All right, man, we got to set up the mortars over here, man, and then hold on, my mom's calling me for dinner. Hold on, I gotta take a fucking piss. I'll be right back." You hear a baby screaming in the background.
Freelancer, time to get to work.
Faye said these bastards make some kind of assets, using it as a weapon.
So,
I know they're making this guy. Shut it all down.
Man, that power suit looks pretty sweaty. I ain't gonna lie.
Owen, what's the plan here?
Picking up loads of scars nearby. Take a look around the area, but be careful.
I like numbers. I like seeing numbers. Especially yellow numbers.
Right. Checking out the Scar Camp some more.
Look at all the weapons! Oh, and the turrets! Better move quickly.
Oh, our AI companion has a... They have a character. They have a personality. Cool, man. Why did you attack that monster if you were just gonna run away? That was pretty fucked up. There was no reason to do that. Okay, way to waste your ammunition. Your ammunition. That seemed like a dumb idea to do that because you still got damaged. Could've just shoot him. Is that thing gonna blow up? It looks like it's gonna blow up.
Be careful.
Oh look, it's a flamethrower weapon that nobody will probably ever use. Cool. Look at those numbers. Look at those combo numbers. That guy has a cape. Oh, yeah, and he teleports.
It's got silent. Disaster averted. Do you think we get a bonus for... Wait, something's happening.
What the hell was that?
I think... That was whatever laid all the eggs around here. The sound came from below your position. our side, this definitely counts toward hazard pay. There's a train of this acid gun leading down.
Man, that guy's power suit doesn't look so hot. Looks like it's sparking a lot. I don't think it's supposed to do that. Maybe you should heal yourself. So sorry, man. I didn't buy any fucking healing items. I forgot. Is it a giant spider creature? Yep, it's a giant spider creature. It's always a giant spider creature because we can never fucking have any enemy in any other game besides giant fucking spiders. Great. Okay. Basic enemy design 101. Great. Cool. Don't say hype, please.
That was actually just a short version of the full demo that we brought here to LA. So if you want to come by the Anthem Theater here at EA Play.
When can I expect the Anthem beta?
So the question on everyone's mind, when do we get to play?
This October.
So February 22nd, 2019.
Okay, next year.
Xbox One.
When's the beta? Mark your calendars, mark your delays. That game's gonna get so delayed. That game's getting delayed.
I also want to give a big thank you to all of the developers who showcased their games today and everybody working hard at their studios back home around the world. Let's give them all a round of applause. Now, some of what you saw today, you guys have to wait to play. Guys, EA has so much available right now. Now, for those of you keeping score, you can get your free trial of FIFA 18 World Cup today.
I don't care.
You told us about the free trial of Origin Access.
I don't care. What about Yarny? Yep. Yarny.
Is also available today. Plus, you can take on your friends in Command & Conquer Rivals.
You guys talked about, what, six games? Nobody cheered. I love this. This is the worst piece of shit ever made. Okay.
Live tournament is going to begin. I'm going to head outside and check out the game, but I want to thank everybody for coming down to EA Play today and watching the press conference.
All right. The cringe press conference is finally fucking over. Most exciting thing, Yarny. Gonna play that like right now. Because I want to. Other things. I mean, that, what was it called? Sea of Solitude? That looks great. Can't wait to see more of that. Anthem looks okay. It looks fine, but let's be honest, that thing's gonna get delayed. Have no interest in that mobile game. Battlefield 5. It's a Battlefield game. I'm probably gonna buy it because I haven't played a Battlefield game in so long. But, it's a Battlefield game. And then sports. A lot of sports. Cool. Great. Cool. Gonna pause that now. And, I don't even know what to say, to be honest. I really don't. There was really, I'm gonna be honest, it wasn't worth it. It wasn't worth sitting here watching this. I'm gonna get that shit fixed. I don't know why my fucking PlayStation 4 kept, like, disconnecting off the fucking internet browser. That's weird. That never happens to me. But, yeah, I mean, I already made all my opinions voiced. I really don't, like, again, the best thing that came out of this was Yarny and Sea of Solitude. And the rest is, like, games that you get every year. And then Anthem's next year, but it's probably gonna be delayed another, like, 4 months or 2 months. Yeah, the customization, I mean, who cares? Overall, it was kind of a huge disappointment, I'm gonna be honest. It was kind of a really huge disappointment. It was nothing overtly exciting. But again, it's just EA, and we all know that EA wasn't gonna really have nothing crazy to show. The most interesting thing for us is probably, Microsoft, because they're gonna have like a 3-hour press conference when that happens. That's gonna I don't know what the hell's going to happen. I don't know what they're going to talk about for 3 hours, but, was it 3 hours, or is it, like, 2 hours? Maybe it's just 2 hours. Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe it's 2 hours, not 3 hours. What am I saying 3 hours for? Probably 2 hours. Yeah, I mean, that's basically it. hopefully you guys, I'm gonna be honest, you guys didn't enjoy this. You guys probably didn't give a fuck. I don't even give a fuck. Yeah, it was a huge waste of time. I felt like I wasted my time. Hopefully I didn't waste your time too much. Hopefully you was doing something while watching this. See, look at that. That shit went away again. I don't know what the hell is wrong with my PlayStation, but I'll get that fit. You know what? I'm not even gonna do it on PlayStation tomorrow. I'm doing it on my PC. I'm recording off my PC next time I do a goddamn E3 press conference thing. But, yeah. I mean, you guys can like, comment, subscribe. Tell me what you're excited about for E3, at least in terms of EA, or if like you want to see something else, like put that in the comments, because I'll be in there and I'll fucking talk with you for days. Like, I mean, I don't give a fuck. But yeah, I mean, that's pretty much it. So I will see you guys on the next press conference, which tomorrow is Microsoft. Microsoft's starting tomorrow off, right? I think it is Microsoft. Yeah, Microsoft's starting things off tomorrow. Then it's like Digital Devolver, and then not Digital Devolver, Devolver Digital, or whatever the fuck they're called. And then what, the PC games, right? I don't know. So yeah, I'll see you guys then. And as always, thanks for watching.